John chapter 1. The name of this class is Realities Beyond the Seen, and that obviously that relates spiritually. We all understand spiritually that there are yet realities that we have not contemplated or seen or even known existed. And what we're going to be doing is we're going to be studying and seeking the Lord. Our goal is the Lord. What we're preaching is Christ. But we're going to be using several different avenues, and we're going to be sticking with the Word of God in a tremendous way, as you'll see tonight. But we'll be dealing with astrophysics and quantum physics. And if you understand what that is, or if you don't understand what it is, really doesn't matter, because what we're going to be learning is Christ. But we're going to see some things from the scriptures. Scientists call it these things, astrophysics and quantum physics. Astrophysics deals with the heavenly bodies. So if I put this little dot right here on the chalkboard, and then I make the rest of the chalkboard, no, the rest of the wall, no, the rest of the planet, the universe, this little dot would be Earth. That's how small it is. And that's also how big and how many bodies and corporate bodies, constellations, galaxies that are out there. And that little bare dot right there would represent the Earth. In fact, in light of all that, you couldn't even see it, in light of the universe. All right. So studying everything outside of the Earth realm, pretty much, we're going to call astrophysics, which is dealing with heavenly bodies and this sort of thing. I just want you to get the basic concept of this. Quantum physics is just the opposite. It goes the other direction. If the whole Earth were taken into consideration, you saw this dot. Now this dot represents subatomic particles. Okay, what do we mean by subatomic particle? That is something smaller than the atom. Particles smaller than the atom. And we'll get into all this later. We're not really going to be dealing with quantum physics tonight. We're going to be dealing with astrophysics, mainly just by going to scriptures and having a look. But if you've studied anything about the atom, you know that everything's made out of atoms. Everything. You, this, everything is made out of atoms. Okay? But atoms are made out of something too. Smaller particles. And as we'll see, what we would like to get to is the basic foundation of all things. The basic element, if you will. That's the goal of quantum physics. Okay. In astrophysics, they believe, and this is anytime you hear anything about a rocket or a ship going to Mars or sending something out in space, you know, that's going to explore, the main thing that they tell you is, this is, and they'll always say this, I've never heard them not say this, so that we can find the, you know, how the universe was created. Okay. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to show you some things that will show you that ultimately in astrophysics, you're not going to find that answer. You're only going to find it in quantum physics. And there's a reason for that. And yet we're spending billions and billions within the realm of astrophysics, and you have astrophysicists studying all these things. And but I've just made statements. They mean nothing yet. I hope to take a little time to back it up with the Word of God and with some reality from there. All right, so let's we've turned to the Gospel of John, chapter 1 and verse 1. We're going to read verse 1 through 3. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. All things were made by him, and without him was not anything made that was made. We'll stop right there. We'll read a little further in just a second. But for any of you former students who have sat in my John class, you already know that the beginning is not creation, and that these verses clearly declare that there was a beginning before creation, and that beginning is, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. There's the true beginning. Everything begins with God and begins with the Word. And then verse 3 is where what we call the beginning, or creation, started. All things were made by him. By him who? The guy that was in the actual beginning, not the creation beginning. Okay? And when I say the actual beginning, I'm not talking about the actual starting point, but the actual starting source. Because the starting source is eternal, without beginning and without end. Okay? So these verses are showing us two beginnings. One is our true source, our true beginning, and how he created all things. Everything, and again, we're dealing with astrophysics. Every constellation, every galaxy, every black hole, every quasar, everything that you can think of, he created all of that. Okay? Well, there's your answer right there then. There's your source. If you start wrong, you're going to end wrong. The scientists have just, you know, looked all over as far as they could to find God, and yet they say there is no God because we haven't found him. We're going to look at some scriptures to see why that's not been the case. So all things were made by him. Wait a minute, made by him who? Him who is the Word. And without him was not anything made that was made. In him was life. So this means that the life in us is not the light of men. Because he says in him was life and the life was the light of men. The life in us is not the light of men. The life in the Word. Because the him he's referring to is the Word that was from the beginning. See, you say, well, isn't that the same one in us? Yes, but we're talking source. If you're going to take it back to the source, it's not even going to include you. He was, he is to come, period. That's him. In him was life, and the life was the light of men, and the light shineth in darkness, and the darkness comprehendeth it not, or overcame it not. So there's two angles of that. It doesn't comprehend the darkness doesn't comprehend the light. And the darkness doesn't overcome the light. Okay. All of that line from 1 to 5 is really talking about him who is the beginning. It's not even really talking about creation. And in fact, it is. If something is true in spirit, then it will manifest in a like manner, but it'll only be a manifestation of the truth, not the truth itself. Do you understand the difference between a manifestation of the truth and the truth itself? Light is not the truth itself. It's a manifestation of him who is the truth. Darkness is not the truth itself. If this room were dark, You know, I'm not, I don't have a problem with the room being dark, but he who is darkness, the devil, there's the source right there of that. And so, to study these things, you're going to have to see the difference between truths and the truth. Because scientists can hit you with all sorts of truths that are only manifestations of the great truth, the Lord. Okay? All right, so let's go to Psalms. Psalms 19. Recently I taught the book of Psalms in the Bible school here, and I dealt with this chapter, this psalm, Psalm 19. But it's not my purpose to reteach it, but I'm going to allude to it, and those of you who have taken the course should be able to remember what it was we covered. Those of you who haven't always have the option of going back and, if nothing else, getting the Psalms 19 class out of it. You don't have to listen to all the Psalms, but and look at that. But this psalm is really incredible. It really is. Psalm 19, verse 1. The heavens declare the glory of God, and the firmament showeth his handiwork. All right. There's more to it, and we'll get into it in a second. But folks, this is telling you that the heavens and the firmament is not just creation. It is a declaration of what God is like, but it's only a manifestation of that. It's not him. It does declare him. Do we see him? That's the question. And so he says, day unto day uttereth speech, and night unto night showeth knowledge. So he's saying that these heavens and this firmament, every day is declaring something, and every night is declaring something of the glory of God. And I guarantee you're not going to discover it by a telescope. You're going to discover it by the Holy Spirit. Only then will you understand source, which is the Lord himself. There is no speech nor language where their voice is not heard. In other words, the sun, he's going to declare it here in just a second, but the sun rises and sets every day. The moon comes and goes every day. Every day there's this circuit. Every day there's this declaration of something true in God that we only see as astrophysics. Their line is gone out through all the earth, and their words to the end of the world. In them he hath set a tabernacle for the sun, which is like a bridegroom coming out of his chamber, and rejoiceth like a strong man to run a race. His going forth is from the end of the heavens, and his circuit unto the ends of it. And there is nothing hidden from the heat thereof. So he's declaring that the sun rising is a picture every day of this race, of this journey that the sun has made to gain a bride, the bridegroom coming out of his chamber. And and this circuit that he's riding represents Christ in his heart to gain a bride, to gain oneness, not just an agreement. You know, I mean, that's what a lot of marriages are, just some sort of agreement to live together and, you know, have kids and do, you know, join in money. But oneness, and it is declaring mightily, and that's what he's saying here, is that every day God is talking to us through this. Every day, he is speaking, and his speech has gone to the uttermost parts of the earth. That's, And what is it? It's declaring the glory of God. It's declaring the heart of God. It's declaring the, it's not just declaring there is a God. You know, well, look at that. The way that sun keeps on burning but doesn't burn out, that's just magnificent. There has to be a God. No, it represents more than just the fact that there's a God. It represents the very reality that is God, the very heart behind who God is and what he's all about. So, let's go ahead and go to another scripture. Let's go to Hebrews 11. Hebrews 11, and let's go to verse 3. Hebrews 11:3. Through faith we understand that the worlds were framed by the word of God, so that things which are seen were not made of things which do appear. Boy, am I going to have fun with that one when we get into quantum physics. Oh, baby. Boy, is that going to speak to us. But just to take it on the surface, first of all, let me just tell you what this scripture doesn't say. And if you were part of any sort of charismatic church before you came here, then you heard this explanation of this verse. That through faith, God made the worlds, and they were framed by the word of God so that the things which seem, that's what they tell you this verse says, that God created all this through faith. In fact, the faith movement teaches that because I heard them myself. It doesn't say that. It doesn't say it. If you really just look at it, you'll see that it doesn't say it. It says, through faith we understand that this happened. Not through faith it happened.
Amen.
Right? Now, isn't it good that we're in a place that we'll search the scriptures to find out whether the things we're being taught are of God? Because, if, like I said, most of you have been taught what that says. And here was my conclusion. At first I went, okay, oh, wow. You know, I mean, I was just newborn when I joined with a certain ministry and heard that. And I thought, oh, wow, man. And I was told faith is a powerful thing, man. You can create your own worlds and da-da-da-da and all this kind of stuff. And then I remember really looking at it once and going, wait a minute. If God created the worlds and the universe by faith, then faith is greater than God. That actually faith did it, not God. Or God's faith, which makes faith God. Because it's more powerful than God. But God didn't do this through faith. God did it because he's almighty. We, through faith, understand that he did that. Amen? Let's read it again. Through faith, we understand that the worlds were framed by the word of God, so that the things which are seen were not made by the things which do appear. Okay. Now, that can really be taken in a wrong way if you're not careful. So I'm not going to really deal with that right now, but I'm just going to tell you that the explanation of that is not as we probably would suppose either. All right, let's go to Romans chapter 1. Isn't this good, too, that you get the opportunity to just go all through the Bible in one class? I've been to services where preachers preached, and they didn't even have you turn to a scripture. And they never mentioned a scripture. I thought, that's weird. All right, so, Romans 1 and verse 19. That's where we'll start. Because that which may be known of God is manifest in them, for God hath shown it unto them. For the invisible things of Him. Now that's important, because we would immediately read, for the invisible things, the things not seen, the things not yet understood, but it's not talking about some sort of mysteries in the sense of, you know, Gnosticism or some deep thing, but rather these invisible things of Him, of which subatomic particles and bodies so far away we can't see them, represent. Reality beyond the scene. Reality beyond the scene. For the visible things of Him from the creation of the world are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even His eternal power and Godhead, so that they are without excuse. All right. So what is he saying? If you know anything about Romans, he's dealing with the fact that, you know, he gets into the Jews and he gets into the Gentiles, and he says that that even if you're not a Jew, God has declared Himself through the things that He's made. Now, isn't it interesting that most heathen nations sacrificed? I mean, Jesus, that what represents Christianity the most as a symbol? The cross. The cross. And they would sacrifice because they knew they were in trouble and they knew God wanted a sacrifice. Even though they didn't know it was Jesus, and they would use a substitute. You know, some of them would have a volcano and throw a virgin down there. You know, I always thought, well, if I was a virgin and that time was coming up, I'd go find me a guy. You know, but that's me. Well, sorry, I'd like to help you out here. Sorry. But I'm not going to be able to. All right, I'm embarrassing myself. Because when they knew God, and I want you to try to follow the line here, because when they knew God, he's speaking to actual people that knew God. Okay? When they knew God, they glorified him not as God. The problem isn't they don't know God. The problem is that they are not glorifying him as who he is, what he is, the true being that he is. Okay? So they know God, but they're perverting the God image. You see what I'm getting at here? The image is no longer Christ and him crucified. It's no longer a lamb. It's something else. So, because when they knew God, they glorified him not as God, neither were thankful, but became vain in their imaginations, and their foolish heart was darkened. Professing themselves to be wise, they became fools. So, let's just consider what that is. They had an understanding. They had maybe a great understanding, and we're really going to cover that little thought right there a lot in this course, that there is an understanding of things that is not an understanding of him. And you can know a lot of stuff and not really know him. A lot of stuff. And so, professing themselves to be wise, they became fools. And change the glory of the incorruptible God into an image made like corruptible man and birds and four-footed beasts and creeping things. So, as we saw in the scriptures just before this, and what we're going to see in the rest of the scriptures is, and David even declared, I forget right now which psalm it was, but David declared, when you consider the sun, the moon, and the stars, and all of the fabulous. What is man that thou art mindful of him? And so what we see here is God set in the heavens, God set before all men a testimony in the heavens of his reality, and man has rejected what's incorruptible. And he takes something that's corruptible, man, beast, creeping things, those things, things of the earth, and says, that's God. That's what God's like. Well, they don't know the heavens. Not as God would have them know it. They know there's a sun. They know there's a moon. They know that there's all these bodies up out there called stars. But they haven't seen the Lord. They don't understand that what we have not yet perverted. I was thinking about this. What we have not yet corrupted. Someone would say to me, oh, but we have already corrupted outer space. I mean, circulating around our planet is massive amount of space junk. And you know that, burnout satellites and, you know, leftover cartridges and this and that. I mean, I don't know if you really realize it, but there's a massive amount of space junk circulating around our planet. So you say, well, see, we've even corrupted the heavens. Well, not really. That's still in our atmosphere. That's still in our realm. That's still caught up in our gravity. Held by our pulls. See, but you get on out there. You get on out there. Places that we can't even see that far, much less go. Come on, we barely went to the moon. You know? And you'd think if we went to the moon, we should have been on Mars like 10 years afterwards or something like that. You know, it's showing the finiteness and the corruptibility, and this very earth is a declaration of when we put our hands to it, we corrupt it. Everything turns to stuff, dung, when we get hold of it, you know. And so, changed the glory of the incorruptible God into an image made like corruptible man and birds and four-footed beasts and creeping things. All right, let's go to Colossians chapter 3. You know, Colossians is just a really good book for this kind of stuff. Tell you another really good book for this kind of stuff in the Old Testament is Isaiah. Let's see. Colossians 3, verse 2. Set your affections on things above, not on things on the earth. Set your affections on things above, not on things on the earth. And as you know, this doesn't say set your affection on things above, not on earthly things. It says things on the earth. You know, it's not dealing with earthly things. It's dealing with things on the earth. And so in the spirit, It is speaking of things, and I want to deal with this maybe next class, I don't know. It is speaking of things more real or outside of our realm that more clearly declare the Lord. That you would come closer to discovering the Lord. And I'll deal with all that, like I said, possibly next class. But just giving you an example over in Philippians, just a few pages over, Philippians 3. Philippians 3:19. Whose end is destruction, whose God is their appetite, and whose glory is in their shame, who mind earthly things. Okay, so the spiritual reality is this. Don't set your affections on things where moth and rust and death can steal away, but on something above. Okay. The physical manifestation of the spiritual truth is, in astrophysics, that there are things that will come more clearly to explain reality to you than the earth. The earth may explain your reality. Amen. But it's not going to explain his. Not as clearly. And we'll see that as we go. And so here he's saying, whose glory is in their shame, who mind earthly things. And, you know, we would get upset. We would get upset with those people who mind earthly things. They would, you know, be caught up in having the best, you know, car, or the best stereo, or the best this or that, or, you know, an iPod, you know, or iPhone, or whatever. Not against those things, I'm just saying. I mean, that's some people, you know, but guess what? That's not what this is talking about. That's not what it's talking about at all. And whole churches are built on stamping out those who would, you know, dress nice or something. I don't know what. But, you know, ridiculing them when that's not even what it's talking about. And, in fact, if you want to know what is the category under which these people who mind earthly things fall, you have to read the verse in front of it, which is verse 18. For many walk, of whom I have told you often and now tell you even weeping, that they are the enemies of the cross of Christ, who mind earthly things. All right. So you're getting a little picture. You're getting a little picture that God isn't near as concerned with your outward as he is your inward. And God isn't near concerned with your earth life as he is the realm of his life. And I say that specifically because I'm not just saying his life because we just put it in us and then make that it. But there is a realm of his life which the heavens declare. And so, let's go just a few more pages over back to Colossians chapter 1 and verse 16. And so up to this point, it has told us that there are heavenly realities that are trying to speak to us. Literally. I mean, if that's true in the spirit, the physical manifestation of the truth is there are realities in the actual heavens that are trying to speak to us day by day, night by night, as it says in Psalms 19. Can I get amen? Amen. I mean, that's the case. But you're never really going to see the truth by looking at truths. You will only comprehend the truths by seeing the truth. I think Albert Einstein proved that. Good for you. I'm glad to hear that. Because I believe certain things led Albert Einstein to his conclusions, and he's considered probably the greatest physicist that there was. All right, we're in Colossians 1 in verse 16. Talking about Jesus. For by him were all things created that are in heaven and that are in earth, visible and invisible. You could say astral bodies and quantum particles. That's the physical manifestation of the spiritual truth, but you can say that. Whether they be thrones or dominions or principalities or powers, all things were created by him and for him. And he is before all things, and by him all things consist. Now, the word, when it says by him all things consist, it's really, the actual Greek there is by him all things are held together. You take Jesus out of this world, it'll just fly apart. It'll, like an atomic bomb, the particles will start beating against one another until there's an explosion that'll destroy everything around it. And so the explanation here is that all things were created by him and for him, and he is before all things. All right. Now, I want to tell you that though everything in the astral world out there, of all comets and nebulas and galaxies and constellations, and everything right down to this planet, cups, glass, water, liquid, fire, everything is made of particles. Light is particles. Guess who proved that? Yeah, Albert Einstein, that's right. It's also waves. But all of those things, no matter how diverse, no matter how different, come from atoms. And atoms come from subatomic particles. Every literal living or solid matter type things or light or whatever, all of it except one thing, God. All of it is reflecting certain realities. It's declaring his Godhead. But he's not made of particles. Right. So, and he is before all things, and by him all things consist, and he is the head of the church, or the body, the church, who is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, that in all things he might have the preeminence, for it pleased the Father that in him should all fullness dwell. So, he created all things, he's before all things, da-da-da-da-da-da-da, yeah, you're great, God, you really know how to create, you're a big shot, you've made incredible, duck-billed platypus and a quasar and, just the variety of insects just blows my mind, and da-da-da-da. But when he gets right down to it, he just in passing says all of that, and he gets to the heart of the thing, and he is the head of the body. His body. The church. The firstborn from the dead, that in all things he might have the preeminence. All of those things are trying to point us to the core, to the foundational reality that makes them all exist and consist. trying to bring it all into one reality, and that reality has nothing to do with insects or matter or physics. It has everything to do with his heart for a bride, for a body. Well, let's go beyond that. It is his desire to bring us in oneness with him so that the things that are true of him may be true of us. That all of the lack and all of the corruptibility that is us will be replaced, exchanged, moved out. I am crucified, Christ liveth. Is there hope for anybody in that statement? There's hope for everybody. Because that means no matter what your problem is, no matter what you think you can't overcome, the good news is you don't have to overcome. Jesus' life overcomes, and you're one with him. And you're never going to get over that hump by looking at you and looking at him up in the heavens and trying to get him to give you strength to get over that hump. I've been praying over this issue for years. I've been fasting. Well, how's that been working for you? Why isn't it working? Come on, that's the religious way. Prayer, searching the scriptures, going to church. Folks, going to church will never work. You got to be the body, the church. The body of Christ. You got to be the extension of him. You got to be his hands and his feet. You got to be his mouth and his eyes. You've got to become that, or you're going to just struggle with your stuff all your life. And that's why? Because that's you. And, I've said this a few times before, but I'll say it again. There are things that I just thought, there are things that I used to do wrong, when I got saved, and I'd go, okay, Lord, help me with this and deal with that and da-da-da-da. But there were things that I knew it wasn't just stuff I was doing, it was me, and I was corruptible, and I thought, there's no way that I can ever get over this because this isn't something I'm doing, this is me. And I thought, there's no hope then until I realized what the cross was all about. And that is not just death. Not just death. Yes, death, but not just death. Not only death, and not even primarily death. All y'all talk about is death. No, we don't. If you want to know all we talk about, I'll tell you what it is in one word. Jesus. I talk way more about Jesus than I talk about death. And to prove it, somebody that really wants to prove this, you go back over the tape since I was, early 20s, and you go and just record every time I say death and every time I say Jesus. And in fact, you can start right in the back after this class. But I can tell you of a truth. I guarantee I say Jesus because I understand that only death with Jesus did it and only resurrection with Jesus did it. And that there's no hope in death. There's hope in Christ. But the way to get into union with Christ is to die to your old life and become his body so that his virtues, his life, his character, his mind can be in you. Aren't you tired of being insane? Well, get his mind in you. You won't have to be insane anymore. You can be out of sane. Whatever that means. And then just finishing up verse 9, for it pleased the Father that in him should all fullness dwell. I like that. It doesn't say, for it pleased the Father that he should have all fullness. I mean, these things are very specific, folks. If you ever see, you'll never see them until you see Jesus. But when you see Jesus, you get a new Bible. No, not a, you know, it's just the same old Bible, but it starts reading differently. This doesn't say for that pleased the Father that he'd get all fullness. It says in him, and guess who the him is that he's talking about there? Christ and the church, his body. In him dwells all the fullness of his patience and his love and his kindness and his long-suffering. In him dwells all of that. And it's declaring something glorious to us. It's declaring the heavens. We're seated together in heavenly places in union with Christ Jesus. And the heavens are declaring this reality. But again, you can't study the truths because there's no life in the truths. There's no life in the physical manifestation of the spiritual truth. There's only life in him. And then it won't be just a physical manifestation. You'll be living by that oneness, and yes, you'll manifest it, but the manifestation actually, before oneness is the hard part. The manifestation after oneness is the easy part. Because then you go, well, I just manifested some love. No, no, you don't say that. You say, Christ just manifested me. Christ just did that through me. Because it's not about attributes. You're not after attributes. You're not after being more patient. You're not after that. If you are, become Buddhist. They seem to get there quicker than we do. You know? I mean, if it's attributes, then change religions because, you know, many of them are doing better than we are. But if it's Christ you're after, the attributes come with it. You know? I remember in my early days when I'd pray for people to get the Holy Spirit and they say, well, do you think I'll ever speak in tongues or something? I said, well, I don't know. I always looked at getting the Holy Spirit like getting a pair of shoes. The tongues come with it. That was my Texas childish, immature way of seeing it. So my conclusion on that is, no, if you haven't spoken tongues yet, don't worry about it. Keep your eyes on Jesus, and God will take care of all the manifestations. Okay? Because as sure as I say that, somebody's going to go, well, I never have. Tongues didn't come with mine. Well, you got slippers. Don't worry about it. Okay, let's go to Romans chapter 11. I need to quit talking here and keep sharing. Romans 11 and verse 36, and this is just confirming what we read in Colossians 11, 36. And it says, for of him and through him and to him are all things, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. Most of you know when you say amen, it's over with. Right? Well, amen. Of him and through him and to him are all things, and to whom be glory forever. And so, what is this saying, basically, in the verses that we read over in Colossians? Well, it's saying that Jesus didn't just make this big old universe, you know, which we wouldn't even show up, but he didn't just make this, but it's by him and of him and to him. It is all, he is the pattern of the whole thing. He is the reality that if you really see him, then you'll comprehend realities that are here. Make sense? that he's not just the creator, is what it's saying. It's not just by him, but of him and to him and through him, and for him. And, you know, that's what they're all saying. It's saying, to whom be glory forever and ever over everything. Nothing left but him and what's one with him. It's all that's eternal now. Okay. We need to try to finish this up. They're showing me signs saying bad things about the time. Hebrews chapter 1. Hebrews 1 and verse 1. God, who at sundry times and in diverse manners spoke in time past unto the fathers by the prophets, hath in these last days spoken unto us in Son, whom he hath appointed heir of all things, by whom also he made the worlds. There it is. By whom also he made the worlds. Get ready. Who, being the brightness of his glory and the express image of his person. All right, so he says he made the worlds, but he himself is the brightness. No matter how gloriously bright a star-going supernova would be, like if you were on a close planet and it went supernova, just before your flesh was incinerated, you would say, wow, that was bright. Well, that's nothing. That's just a small little picture, you know. And you know what a star-going supernova creates, don't you? What else? It explodes into throwing out. There's a taking in, but there's a throwing out. And stars, other suns. Other suns are made by the death of a sun. Anyway, sorry. He is the brightness of that. I need to hit two more scriptures in Ephesians and then we'll stop here. Ephesians chapter 3 and then we'll take our little break. Ephesians 3:9. All right. So here we've discovered the heavens declaring the glory of God. We've discovered this whole line of how there are these invisible things to which he wants our eyes open. But now Paul starts talking plainly, Ephesians 3:9, and to make all men see what is the fellowship of the mystery. Notice that he can't make all men see the mystery. He can only fellowship with it. To make all men see what is the fellowship of the mystery, which from the beginning of the ages hath been hidden in God. You see that? From the beginning of the world, from the beginning of time, the beginning of all of this, have been hidden in God who created all things by Jesus Christ. You see that? Who created all things by Jesus Christ. There's a lot of hidden stuff in quantum physics. There's a lot of hidden stuff in astrophysics. There's a lot of hidden stuff in the Lord. And until you're discovering the true realities, how are you going to even explain? You'll give some dumb explanation that has no ground for anything other than, well, you know, there, you know, quantum theory. You know, the deepest depth of quantum theory is theory. That's all it is. But it'll only be theory until you understand reality, and then you can explain manifestation. To the intent that now unto the principalities and powers in heavenly places might be known by the church the manifold wisdom of God according to the eternal purpose which he purposed in union with Christ Jesus our Lord. And then finally, the first chapter of Ephesians, and this will be our last scripture, Ephesians 1:10. That in the dispensation of the fullness of time, so here, space and time is being folded up, that in the dispensation of the fullness of time he might gather together in one all things in Christ, both which are in heaven and which are on earth, even in him. And so here we see the great gathering of reality, the things of heaven and earth. None of it makes true sense until it is all not just seen in union with him, but it actually doesn't work. In fact, you're not going to see it unless you become one with that reality. That this union with him is what it was all about. And all of these things are trying to explain that, whether they be astrophysics or quantum physics, they're all have keys that unlock them, every one of them. And the key is seeing Christ in that angle. All right. Let's take a break, and we'll come back for class number 2.